हेलो एवरीवन। In this particular session, we'll see what are principal planes and then how they are formed, and what are the magnitudes of principal stresses. We'll straight away go ahead. Okay, the planes without shear stresses are referred to as principal planes. The stresses on these principal planes are referred to as principal stresses. Here I want to make a couple of points. The spelling of principal, 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 important, are main stresses, are main planes. That's why it is PAL, not PLE. Don't make a mistake of writing that way. So they are principal planes, principal stresses. Okay, then one more thing is, any plane, you have studied that there will be normal stress and then there will be shear stress. On any plane, we have seen that there will be a normal which is perpendicular to this, which we have called it as a sigma, maybe tensile, maybe compressive, and parallel to the plane we have seen that there will be a tau which will be trying to rotate the element in clockwise manner or anticlockwise manner. Accordingly, it will be positive or negative. We have studied. So invariably, generally, normal stress and then shear stresses will be there. Now if you find a plane without any shear stress, means there is a plane with only normal stress and maybe a tensile, maybe a compressive, but there is no shear stress, such plane will be referred to as principal plane. That is what the point over here. So very easy to remember, the planes without shear stresses are referred to as principal planes, and the stresses on these planes are referred to as principal stresses. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. Okay, here already there is one biaxial stress element. We have discussed this with the same magnitude, so consider the same biaxial stress element for which Mohr circle is already drawn. You know how to draw the coordinates of the first vertical plane is 80, 25. It is there here. This is 30 minus 25, it is there. You just join, you get a point on x-axis, I mean point of intersection on x-axis, you draw the circle. That's how you have drawn. Now further, the origin of planes is designated as OP. You know how to find parallel to this vertical plane, which is represented by this point. You draw a line where it cuts the surface, I mean circumference, is known as OP. Origin of planes is there. Now on the circle, can you identify the points representing the planes without any shear stresses? Okay, here every point on the circle is representing some or the other plane, right? If you take a point A itself, there is a normal stress of magnitude 80 represented along x-axis, and there is a shear stress which is represented as y-coordinate because it is tau, right? Now if you go on moving this point, here also there is a maximum shear stress, but there is some normal stress, and if you come down here, both the stresses are getting reduced, and then if you come to this point, what is the coordinate? There is some sigma, but there is no shear stress. Similarly, this point is having a magnitude of normal stress right from O to this point, and there is no shear stress. So such two points are referred to as principal planes. So they are P and Q. Okay. So S, they are points P and Q on the normal stress axis, on the normal stress axis, where the circle cuts. Those two points are representing principal planes. Okay. Now, the coordinates of these points P and Q be 15, 0 and 85, 0. I've been telling it is not exact values, just I have taken for the sake of understanding. So 15, 0 and 85, 0, let us say. Now the point Q, okay, the point Q with higher stress represents major principal planes, because the P has got 15 and Q has got 85. The higher magnitude point, or the point Q with higher stress, represents major principal plane. So the other point, which is having lesser magnitude, is referred to as a minor principal plane or minor principal stress. Now, can you imagine where and how these planes are on the stress element? Because 85, 0 represents, the point Q represents a plane. Now, how and where this plane is? We'll see it. Okay, principal planes. Now you know already that planes originate from OP. That's why we have called this as origin of planes. All the planes should originate from here. And if you are going to that point Q, so that represents a plane M, right, which will be nothing but a major principal plane. Or if you put this plane over here, there, okay, that will be nothing but a plane without any shear stress. Okay, the plane represented by Q is along the line MQ. You can just see here, MQ through OP, through OP. That is actually OP to Q. I have extended up to M so that I can refer it to as MQ. Now, and on the stress element, it can be shown as line MJ on the stress element, which is a major principal plane. Now you have to draw the line parallel to that. You can just see there. If you put that as MJ, so that is nothing but a plane without any shear stress, and then with a major principal stress with a magnitude of 85, and then it is positive value. So major principal stress is tensile, and moreover it is having so much of angle. We can just measure this angle so that you will come to know that with horizontal, what is the angle made by principal plane, right? Now similarly, where is minor principal plane? Okay, that is the one. So origin of plane to the point where the plane is represented. So OP to P, that line represents minor principal plane. So where is minor principal plane? It is the plane represented by the point P on the plane, right? And the plane will be along the line NP. The point is P, it is representing a plane, and it is along the line NP. N is like MP, MQ, we have like NP. I should have written N here. Anyway, it may come. Yeah, NP, right, through OP. Now on the stress element, it will be as shown in figure, and it will be known as minor principal plane. Now how do you do that? You should draw a line parallel to that there. So that represents minor principal plane. And because you can just see here, we are joining the two points on the circumference from diametrically opposite points. That's why this angle is 90 degrees. So to say, the angle between principal planes is always 90 degrees. It is stated here, note that the two principal planes are always perpendicular to each other as they are represented by two points diametrically opposite to each other on the Mohr circle. And then geometry also tells that if you join such two points, diametrically opposite two points, any point on the circumference will be getting the angle between those two lines as 90 degrees. Right? So this is how to identify from the Mohr circle where the principal planes are represented by the points. And then if you know OP, how to identify the inclination or orientation of principal planes, major and minor both. Okay, with this we'll discuss in this session about friction. Friction is an interesting force. That is the first statement I would like to make, and then we'll discuss about it. And you know about the forces, that is resolution of a force, resultant of forces, equilibrium condition, etc. There are so many things that we have studied about forces, and this is also, that is friction also, just a force. So you can treat it as it is, but there is an adjective, interesting force. We'll see how interesting and then why it is so interesting and how it is relevant. Okay, so frictional force comes into action only if required, only if there is a necessity. That is an important point. So it will not just come as it is, or it will not be there just as it is. It comes into action, it gets mobilized, it gets activated only when there is a need, right? So that's an important point. Frictional force gets developed between two solid surfaces in contact. Yeah, we are not talking about liquids or fluids here. We are talking about solid surfaces which are in contact, and then they are rough. And obviously one surface puts friction on the other surface. So whenever one surface tries to move past the other, there will be frictional force. If there is no motion or tendency of motion, there is no friction. That's an interesting point. And it is there only for solid surfaces. In case of fluids, the resistance for motion is given a name, viscosity, and then it has got quite different properties. So here we are talking about friction. It's called a dry friction or friction between the two surfaces. Okay, magnitude of frictional force gets adjusted as much needed to hold the object into equilibrium. Of course, this is within a particular limit. Means the magnitude of frictional force gets mobilized or comes into action to bring the system or to bring the body into equilibrium. To that extent only the force gets developed. That is an interesting part. That's why I told you that it is an interesting force. We'll see in more detail in the next slides. So can you just imagine the world if there is no friction at all anywhere? It is a difficult life, because without friction, can you imagine? Just see, you will not be able to walk. Do you agree? Because unless you push back the floor, you will not be able to go ahead. If your feet slips off the surface, you will not be able to move. So there is no way that you can walk on the floor, right? If you have gone through an experience of walking on very smooth, oily surface, you will realize that it is quite difficult to walk, right? So like that, no vehicles can move. Unless there is a friction, the tire will not be able to push the vehicle forward. If the tire tries to rotate without any friction, the vehicle will not be able to move. The vehicles will not move if there is no friction. You will not be able to pick up a glass of water. Simple. If you want to pick up a glass, right, forget about holding a hand below, right? If you want to pick it up like that, right, you have to have a friction between your fingertips and then a glass. And then if you don't have that friction, you will not be able to, it slips off, right? You will not be able to get it off the table. No games you could have played. I mean, every game will have to have somewhere, some way friction, right? If there is no friction, then you cannot imagine that you can play. For example, shuttle badminton, you hit a shuttle and it just flies off. If there is no air resistance or friction, right, it just goes off, right? You will not be able to move, first of all, right? So that's an interesting situation. Situation would be comparable to space, where there is no gravity. If there is no gravity, there is no normal reaction, there is no friction. That way it is. So no energy loss, the brakes of the vehicles will not be able to function. How to stop the vehicles? Now, flow of water in pipes and channels will have terrific energy. How to control the flow in the river, etc. will have a lot of friction. Because of that, the velocity is reduced. And then if there is no friction, it will be having tremendous energy. It will score everything and then smash everything and then flows off. It will be a chaos, right, everywhere. So that is the importance of friction. Anyway, we'll have to put it in conceptual manner. Let us see how it will be. Many funny situations can arise. You can imagine, you can discuss, you can write a beautiful essay, a world without friction, right? Anyway, we'll go ahead. First of all, let us say there is no friction. It is a smooth contact surface, no friction. In such case, when you apply a force P, it just slides off, right? So as the surface of contact is smooth, where an external force P is applied, as the surface of contact is smooth, the block shown here and the surface shown here will not have any friction. It is smooth, and whenever an external force P is applied, no frictional force gets developed. You cannot have, because it is smooth, and hence the body moves and gets accelerated, right? When you apply a force, it just moves off with acceleration. Acceleration equal to P is given by P equal to M into A, right? So that's how it is. Now consider a rough surface of contact, right? The friction exists. How? Now consider an object sitting on horizontal surface as shown, having weight 100 newtons. Okay, here I have considered a block on a horizontal surface. Yeah, I mean horizontal surface because if it is inclined, there will be tendency of motion. So I have kept it horizontal, a block weighing 100 newtons. When you have a situation something like this, then it will have automatically a normal reaction of 100 newtons to keep the object in equilibrium. Now, whenever there is a block kept on horizontal surface, it is having a gravitational force which is called as weight. And when the force is acting, it should move, but it's not moving because this force has blocked by a normal reaction of exactly equal magnitude. And because 100 downwards, 100 upwards, the sigma Fy is equal to 0, because of that it is in equilibrium, right? So the normal reaction comes into action equal to the magnitude of weight then, right? If you don't have that much of resistance, it sinks. Because there is a solid surface we have considered, right? There is equal and opposite magnitude of reaction, normal reaction. Now, as it is, Now there will not be any frictional force. Now where the frictional force will be, right? Will it be this way or will it be that way? How the frictional force will be, right? The very important point that one should bear in mind is, if there is no tendency of motion, right, it is sitting quietly, there is no friction, simple, right? So here absolutely there is no frictional force that will be developed. Okay, imagine an external force of 5 newtons is applied as shown in figure. Sooner the frictional force gets activated. Now see, yeah, just see simultaneously, you apply a force and there is an equal and opposite magnitude of frictional force. The 5 newtons you have applied, and then 5 newtons is a resistance force, which we are calling it as frictional force at the bottom, right? Now interestingly, it will be exactly 5 newtons and brings the object into equilibrium. Yeah, you apply 5 newtons, it has risen to 5 newtons. You apply 6 newtons, it would have come to 6 newtons and keeps the body into equilibrium, right? You try to push a table off the floor with little effort, it will not move, because whatever amount of force that you have applied onto the table, right, there is a frictional force which is developed at the bottom, exactly equal to the magnitude of force that you have applied. Hence the body is in equilibrium. So sigma fx is equal to 0. Hence there is no motion. Okay. So we say the frictional force is activated, mobilized, right? It comes into action only when there is a tendency of motion. If there is no applied 5 newton force, there is no frictional force. If you apply just 1 newton, this will also be just 1 newton. That's an interesting part. It comes into action as per the requirement we have said in the slide number 1. Okay. Now the same thing. Now imagine the external force is 15 newtons as shown in figure. Now again the frictional force gets activated. Now look at that, 15 newtons I applied, 15 newtons is the resistance that is developed. Interestingly, it will be exactly 15 newtons to bring the object into equilibrium. Okay, we say the more frictional force is mobilized. We say more frictional force is applied, developed or mobilized. Okay. Similar story, let us imagine an external force is increased to 20 newtons as shown in figure. Now the frictional force gets mobilized to 20 newtons and keeps the system into equilibrium. Say this is a particular condition, right? I am going on increasing the applied force, it has risen to now 20. 20 is the mobilized frictional force, right? So here there is one more figure in which I have shown a general condition. Weight is acting, there is a normal reaction, and you know that normal reaction will be equal to W itself. And when you apply P, whether it is 1 newton, 5 newton, 15 newtons up to 20 newtons, accordingly FR has changed, the frictional force has changed its magnitude and adjusted such that the body has come into equilibrium. Okay, so we can say as the external effort to move the object increases, the frictional resistance also increases accordingly. Now let R be the resultant of normal reaction and frictional force. Now where is that R? Resultant of frictional force and normal reaction. Now resultant of these two perpendicular forces will be somewhere there. You know how to find resultant, R equal to square root of, and so on and so forth. Okay, that's the one, right? We have to remove these two and then place this. Resultant is a single replacing force for the given forces, so R, and it is having an inclination of beta with the normal to the surface. To the surface there is a normal, to the normal the resultant is making an angle of beta. Here the angle made by the resultant reaction R with the normal to the surface is known as angle of obliquity. Now whenever there is FR, NR, and then NR and FR will have a resultant reaction, beta will be angle of obliquity. If there is no external force, there is no FR, and beta would be zero, because W will be exactly balanced by NR, there is no question of R. Okay, so represented by the angle beta. Beta is angle of obliquity. Okay, now limiting friction, what does it mean? Now let us imagine an external force is increased. Now we are increasing, I said 5 newtons, 15 newtons, 20 newtons. Now let us say it is increased little more, say 21 newtons as shown in the figure. Now it is an interesting point that 20 newtons frictional force will not increase beyond that, say, right? So, and now let us say the frictional force mobilized goes to a magnitude of 20 newtons and there it stops, right? It will not increase beyond particular magnitude. In this case it is 20 newtons, right? It stops increasing. Beyond that it will not increase, right? So hence the object moves off, because 21 newtons is there, 20 newtons is there, the resultant force would be 1 newton, because sigma fx, if you do 21 plus and then this is minus, so plus 21 minus 20, that will be equal to rightwards 1 newtons. With that 1 newton, this object moves off the equilibrium, right? Here we say the frictional force has a limiting value of 20 newtons beyond which it will not increase, right? It depends upon many factors like the type of surface in contact, material, etc. But always there is some magnitude at which the frictional force can rise up to and there it stops. That is maximum frictional force, which we refer it to as limiting frictional force. Okay, here we say the frictional force has a limiting value of 20 newtons and that is maximum frictional force mobilized, which is FR with a suffix max, right? In earlier slides I have written just FR, but here I am writing FR max. The maximum value of frictional force is 20 newtons. As I have told you in the first slide, it is an interesting force. It gets mobilized or activated as per the requirement to bring the system into equilibrium up to a particular limit. The first slide, if you just see, right? So it is now rising up to 20 newtons and it has stopped. Now what we can say? The ratio of maximum or limiting frictional force to the normal reaction is known as coefficient of friction, represented by the letter mu. Okay, so maximum frictional force is 20, normal reaction is 100. So what happens here? The coefficient of friction will be equal to mu equal to 20 divided by 100, it is 0.2. Okay, so mu is equal to 0.2 and that will be equal to tan phi. Now what is this tan phi? Let's see. Let R be the resultant of normal reaction and maximum frictional force. Okay, FR, it is not just plain FR now. Now if it is FR max and NR, and resultant of these two is, let us say, R. Okay, that is replaced. That is replaced by R. Okay, here the angle made by the resultant R, resultant reaction R, with the normal to the surface, again there is a normal here, normal to the surface, this angle is known as angle of friction, represented by the letter phi. Earlier when FR was not maximum, we called it as angle of obliquity. Now that angle of obliquity has maximum value, right? And that is referred to as phi. Okay, now angle of friction is a maximum angle of obliquity. Okay, I think you will appreciate what I have told, right? Because here I can tell there is a normal reaction of 100, and then when it was only 5 newtons, let us say to the some scale, the resultant reaction was something like that, right? Here there was some angle, we called it as angle of obliquity, and when this frictional force increased to 15 newtons, right, the resultant reaction would be something like that, the angle of obliquity little more, and when it is 20 newtons like that, right, so resultant reaction will be still oblique, right, this angle we called it as still beta. But we observe that when it is 21 newtons, this doesn't go beyond 20. So 20 is the maximum. So angle made over here is the maximum. And this angle, which is now represented by phi, is angle of friction. Earlier angles which were lesser than this, which we called it as beta, are angle of obliquity. And maximum angle of obliquity is known as angle of friction, and typically represented by the letter F, letter phi. Okay, now what to appreciate here is, what I am trying to do is impending motion. So this is where your earlier knowledge of Mohr's circle gets attached to friction, and then afterwards we'll go on applying it to soil. Okay, what to appreciate here is the object goes out of equilibrium not just because of high normal stress, the weight 100 newtons. Now you can just see here 100, if I make it as 110 newtons, this will not move, right? Imagine a situation where 21, 20 is not there, just 100 is there. I'll make it as 110 or 200 or 300, right? So what happens is normal reaction will be getting increased accordingly. The body is still in equilibrium, right? So maximum or higher value of normal reaction or weight will not be causing the motion, or it will not be putting the object out of equilibrium. Higher value of normal force, we can say here, right? Now also, not because higher shear stress, that is applied forces 21 newtons, right? Now here 21, now if you apply 500 newtons as the weight and then apply 21 newtons, it may not move. You can just see here, heavy object you have, right? If you are able to push your mobile on the let us say on the table with a very small force, but with the same force, because it is going out of equilibrium with some magnitude of the force, if the same force if I apply to the table, it will not be able to move, right? Whatever force that is possible to move the table, the same force if you apply for a almira or your cupboard, it will not be able to move, right? That is to say, this 21 newtons is not a force which will be causing the motion, or which is the reason for the object to go out of equilibrium. Then what? But this is the point, but it is because of such a combination of normal and shear stresses. This is normal reaction and then frictional force, that combination, or the weight and then active force, that combination, or in other words, the weight and applied external force, the combination of these two should be such that it should cause the motion, right? The magnitudes matter. Where the angle of obliquity is maximum and reach angle of friction, or angle of friction phi, right? So if you have 121, resultant of which will be making an angle of phi there, right? When you make a resultant like that, right, this will be resultant, and this resultant is having this angle, right? The same thing when you show by parallelogram here, the same angle is shown there. You can just see they are opposite angles which are equal in magnitude, and if this reaches phi, then this goes out of equilibrium. So that is what is shown there, R, which is resultant of 121, right? And then angle is represented by phi, that is angle of friction. Okay, now we'll relate this to Mohr's circle. Okay, stress on any given plane is represented by stress element, biaxial stress element. We have a general biaxial stress element, and now we are interested in finding out the probable plane of failure, motion or failure. That is what synonymously I am using. Excuse me. Okay, here for a given stress system, let Mohr circle be as shown in the figure. Okay, I have drawn the Mohr circle. You know how to draw. On some plane M, say the normal and shear stresses are 60 and 33. I have a plane somewhere, and then the stresses are 60 and 13. The plane is represented by the point M. Okay, now that plane, when I draw through OP, I cut there. You already seen it in Mohr circle video. So here it is 60 and 33. What 60 means is it is horizontal distance up to this point 60, and this is 33. There the point is, this point M represents the plane M. Okay, that's how it is. Now resultant of two stresses are, mean the resultant of 60 and 33, the resultant of these two stresses R makes an angle of alpha between the normal and R. Now how do you do that? Now if you have, I'll just try to show it here, normal reaction of 60, so it is perpendicular 60, and this is 33 positive, so I'm considering this part, so this is rightwards like that. So there is frictional force or tangential force. There is a, this is going outwards, right? So this I will try to draw it over here so that it becomes easy for me to show the resultant. So this normal reaction, which is 60, this tangential force 33, and they have a resultant reaction like that, and the angle made by the resultant reaction with the normal, this angle. Now how do you find this angle? It is angle between the normal stress or normal reaction, right, and the resultant. Now can you find it over here how it will be? So this is now representing a normal stress, and this is tau. The resultant will be nothing but a line joining O to M. Okay, I think I have drawn. Yes, there it is. The resultant R and the angle of obliquity, the angle made by R over here, the same angle is over here, because this is normal, this is tangential stress. The resultant, the angle between resultant and normal, the angle between resultant and normal, this angle is now over here beta, which is angle of obliquity. So okay, now similarly the point A represents a plane with a normal stress 80 and shear stress of 85. 25. Now where is that point? Okay, there it is. So the point A is having 80 and 25. How 80? This magnitude is 80 and this magnitude is 25 vertical, right? The resultant of these two is over here by a red line, and angle made by angle of obliquity is shown over here, only this much. If you compare it with earlier angle of obliquity, the angle of obliquity is reduced, though the observe here, though the normal stress has increased, and then slightly the shear stress is decreased, but angle of obliquity is drastically reduced. And then when the obliquity angle is less, it is safe. So compared to the point M, compared to the plane M, the plane A is more safe. The resultant stress makes lesser angle of obliquity, making it more safe plane. The plane is more safe. Okay. But we should search for a plane having normal and shear stress such that the angle of obliquity is maximum. There is a fear of failure, right? We are searching for a plane where the failure is expected, or probable plane of failure. That is what we are trying to see, right? That is where the motion starts off, right? If you are talking about two objects, then there is a motion starts off. If you are inside an material, then there is a failure that starts off. Okay. Now here M is with 60-33, you know that. Let us analyze a plane represented by the point N on the Mohr circle. Somewhere there I have shown a point, and this point again represents a plane there, you know that. The plane is having an orientation OP to N. That line, if I draw, that's how the plane is, and it is more inclined compared to M, so it will be something like that, right, if you put it with respect to M. So let us analyze the plane M, plane N, or the point N representing that plane. Okay. Now the angle of obliquity is increased. Is it true? Just see. Yeah. If I try to draw resultant of the two stresses, there it is. And if I just join O to that N, this angle of obliquity is increased, making it more unsafe. So there is a tendency that it may fail, right? Now if you go on doing that, where will be the point which will be having maximum angle of obliquity? Now obviously, if I go on searching for a point where this angle is maximum, right, so when it becomes tangential, right, because when you go down over here, let us say, the angle of obliquity is decreased. So angle of obliquity increases, and then it reaches a maximum. When you go down, it will again decrease and it becomes zero, and then again it increases, right? So there again, when there is a tangent here, again it will be, this angle will be maximum, right? Okay. Now it is more evident for a point Q, where the resultant stress line becomes tangential to the circle, will have a maximum angle of obliquity. Okay, so when this resultant stress, because you know that resultant is, because it is a sigma and tau, the resultant stress is this, the angle made with respect to sigma axis or normal stress axis, this angle is maximum when it is tangential, right? So that is which will be referred to as angle of friction, and represented by that angle phi. So the point Q represents the plane, probable plane of failure. So this point Q is representing some plane, right? So that point or that plane is having a fear of failure. There is a chance of failure. Now, the orientation of the plane is given by the line OP to Q. Obviously, how do you find the plane? The plane has to start from the point OP. So, from OP, if I join a line like that, so that gives you the orientation of the plane. So, that's how it is. Okay. Now, the orientation of the plane is given by the line from OP to Q. From OP to Q. And if you want to put it there on the biaxial stress system, so that is the plane. That is the plane with fear of failure. Note that phi is not angle made by the friction, angle made by the failure plane. Okay. Now this angle is maximum angle phi, fine. But this is not the angle made by the failure plane with horizontal or vertical. This is not this angle. This angle is totally different, right? So make a clear idea about this. So plane is, this is the plane, right? The angle made by failure plane with horizontal, if you want, it is alpha. Phi is angle of friction, angle made by the resultant reaction with the normal stress. But the plane is OP to Q. That plane is represented over here. The angle made by plane with horizontal may be measured this way or may be measured that way. Here it is shown as alpha. So the failure plane makes an angle of alpha with horizontal as shown in figure. Okay, that's how to find out plane of failure, probable plane of failure. Okay, thank you. We'll stop here.